President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. welcomes European Commission President Ursula von der Leyen in Malacañang. Our very own Katrina Domingo now joins us with an update. Kat, over to you.
Hi, Carmina. The European Union on Monday backed the Philippines' claims in the South China Sea with European Commissioner President Ursula von der Leyen saying that the regional bloc is ready to help the country by sharing information, conducting threat assessment, and building the capacity of the Philippines Coast Guard. Von der Leyen said that the EU actually, she described the 2016 arbitral ruling as something that is legally binding and that may be used to stabilize the Indo-Pacific region. Von der Leyen underscores that rising tensions in the Indo-Pacific is a global concern as challenges to the rules-based order in our interconnected world affect all countries, not just those involved in the West and the South China Sea issue. Now, with this assurance, Carmina, also comes a pledge of aid. She says that the EU is ready to give the Philippines around 60 million euros in aid for a green economy project. And aside from that, Carmina, the European leader also underscored that the Philippines and the European Union is also working to reestablish negotiations to establish a free trade agreement between the two countries. That's quite important, Carmina, because way back last year, the bilateral trade between the two countries amounted to 18.38 billion euros, but that's only just 0.3% of the European Union's total trade. As we all know, the European Union is the Philippines' fourth largest trading partner, but the Philippines, on the other hand, only ranks as the 42nd largest trading partner of the European Union in the world. It means, Carmina, that a lot more can be tapped from the European region, particularly in the sectors of machinery, animal and vegetable fats and oils, as well as optical and photographic instruments. Now, aside from that, Carmina, aside from those economic pledges and cooperation on the defense and security front, the European Commission president also said that the European Union is looking to transform the Philippines to become a digital hub in Southeast Asia by establishing a fast and reliable connectivity through submarine cables on cybersecurity training, as well as on the development and deployment of 5G services.
Local tourists better gas up as a big-time oil price hike looms Tuesday. Diesel prices will see the biggest jump at 3 pesos and 50 centavos per liter. Kerosene prices will increase by 3 pesos and 25 centavos per liter, while a liter of gasoline will cost 2 pesos and 10 centavos more. Industry players still attribute the price hike to the ongoing oil output cut of 1 million barrels per day by OPEC. Expectations of tightening U.S. crude supply also contributed to the increase in pump prices. Economists project Philippine inflation in July eased for a sixth straight month, with some even seeing headline inflation falling below 5% from June's 5.4%. ING Bank cites favorable base effects while expecting core inflation, which excludes volatile food and energy prices, will also ease to 7% from 7.4%. Meanwhile, Goldman Sachs cites higher vegetable and fish prices that are partially offset by lower electricity rates. The Philippine Central Bank has been on pause after pulling the trigger on 425 basis points off rate hikes to 5.25%, the most aggressive in the region, to fight inflation. The official reading for the July inflation rate is set to be released August 4th, and the BSP's next policy meeting is going to happen August 17th. Over 200 business leaders across 21 countries convened in Cebu over the weekend to propose new frameworks and models to the Asia-Pacific Economic Cooperation meeting this November. Annie Perez gives us a wrap of the third leg of this year's APEC Business Advisory Council meeting.
Business leaders all over the Asia-Pacific convened in Cebu for the past 3 days. They are the APEC Business Advisory Council, composed of 21 member economies. For this year, discussions focused on uplifting the micro, small, and medium entrepreneurs through digital innovation, economic sustainability, and environmental response.
We wanted to make sure that all the suggestion for economic growth and expansion would always take consideration of the needs of the people of this region, specifically helping the micro, small, and medium enterprises business, helping women business, helping indigenous business.
All five technical working groups created toolkits that are accessible to MSMEs. They also crafted frameworks to harmonize standards across the countries. However, they will be presented before a bigger audience this November, where state leaders are included in the discussion at San Francisco, USA. If approved, the frameworks will be implemented across APEC countries.
We have to work with our senior officials. So I think within ABAC, we always have very good opportunities to present our case studies, our solutions. This would be an additional tool for an MSME to really get themselves up to that level that they want to achieve in terms of sustainability.
As for ABAC Philippines, they decided on adopting economic resiliency practices. Leaders created an indemnity program with the National Treasury, where they can secure loans and bonds, including insurance policies in case another pandemic hits. Business leaders are set to lobby this proposal before the president and other stakeholders.
We learn from all countries, all 21 countries. So that's a big thing for us. And we're now able to give better advice to our government officials.
Philippine business leaders add this will tremendously help them stabilize their own financial assets and reduce the impact of losses that will also affect their workforce. Annie Perez, ABS-CBN News.
Philippine Senator Riza Ontiveros says now is the time to bring the West Philippine Sea dispute before the United Nations General Assembly. Her remark comes after several countries reaffirmed their support for the 2016 arbitral ruling that struck down China's maritime claims in the disputed waters. The opposition senator earlier urged the government in a Senate resolution to raise the issue before the United Nations, but was opposed by her colleague, Alan Peter Cayetano. Cayetano argued such action could be taken as a pro-U.S. sentiment. So the Philippine Health Department reminds vulnerable individuals to continue wearing face masks despite the lifting of the state of public health emergency due to COVID. See, the Philippine government earlier lifted all health protocols concerning COVID, including the mandatory wearing of face masks in public transport and health facilities. But Health Secretary Ted Herbosa says those who are immunocompromised and those with COVID symptoms should still wear masks in public spaces. He adds the same practice should be implemented in schools as the new academic year approaches.
So it's very important to stay home, to tell DepEd and the teachers to make sure send home any kid that is coughing or has symptoms of upper respiratory infection. If there is an indication for the individual, the student, to wear a mask, they should be allowed to wear a mask in school, even if wearing of mask is optional or based on the individual needs.
As for the delayed benefits of health workers, Herbosa appeals for more patience, but he assures them they will receive their allowances.
The arrears to pay our health workers who work during the time of COVID is actually billions of pesos. And there was no budget in 2022. So we were able to put it in the 2023 budget. So slowly many health workers are receiving their health emergency allowance. And most of the government hospitals, I'm told, especially the DOH, receive their health emergency allowance. The next phase is really the local government hospitals and the private sector. So we are reviewing. So I told them to hasten distribution.
The Philippine Bureau of Corrections set to meet with forensic experts today, Monday, to investigate if there are mass graves in the National Penitentiary. This comes after human remains were found at the prison's Sputnik area last week. Bucor Chief Gregorio Katapang Jr. says he will excavate all septic tanks inside the prison. Katapang notes the recent string of violence committed inside the facility are stemming from long-standing problems of over-congestion and cultural issues.
Ang latest po is about 30,543 and increasing. Sobra-sobra na po talaga. Hindi na po kaya ng sistema. It is imploding. Ang diferensya lang, nag-aaway sila. And then because they're not getting the right number of hours to sleep. Siyempre, iba rin yung, di ba, pag hindi ka nakatulog na maayos, you're not in your good mood. Bukod sa structural problem natin na kulang tayo ng kulungan, we also have a cultural problem or behavioral problem. Not only about among the PDL, itong problema ng kultura ng mga officials natin, mga correctional officers natin, no? Yung may culture of negligence, the culture of walang pakialaman, the culture of diligensya, the culture of we can get away with it, no? Yun ang gusto kong baguhin.